So we're here today to talk about the heroin deaths that have been happening lately. Have you gotten any sense of if this is an increasing problem in Oakland County?
Well, absolutely. It's up dramatically, but not just Oakland County. It's not an isolated thing. It's up nationally. It's up across the state and it's up across the country. Heroin deaths have spiked dramatically over the last year and a half, 2 years.
Do you know why is that?
Well, there's a number of factors. We're seeing the price point, if you will, of heroin come down pretty dramatically, and then we're also seeing the strength and the potency go up pretty dramatically. And so that confluence of two factors have led to more usage and then more deaths. So we're seeing gateway use, sometimes moms and dads, you know, with kind of traditional prescription pain, pills, opiates. And then we're also seeing young people. And here's where our biggest kind of category that is very concerning to young people. Oftentimes have been starting maybe on some kind of pill, pharmacologically prescribed pill, maybe because of a sports injury or something like that. And then they get hooked. They get connected to that process, that pain relief, that feeling, if you will. The prescription runs out. Then they go look for the same kind of feeling, the same kind of relief elsewhere. And lo and behold, they get out on the street and find out that that pill may cost $50 to $80, and a bundle of heroin may cost, $10.
Wow.
So then it becomes kind of an economic decision of sorts. Excuse me. So then they try that bundle. And again, if you get one of those very potent samples, and, the problem with drug abuse and use on the street is you have no idea what you're getting.
Right.
There's no FDA, there's no content labeling, there's no testing, so you have no idea what's in it. It could have been stepped on, street language meaning cut. What was it cut with? What's the percentage? What's the dosage? What's the strength? All of those questions are not answered, nor are they available at all. And so, the person takes that bindle. And sometimes the first time they take it, it's a death sentence because it literally overwhelms their system. They don't have the tolerance for something that dramatically strong, and it's lights out. And it's very sad, and we're losing a lot of people that way.
Do you know, do you have any sense of how many deaths there have been from this year?
It's hard to quantify because, there's not a category that would say heroin death.
Right.
Because there may be other things in a person's system, and maybe other kinds of opiates or drugs or alcohol. So, it would be a death due to substances,
right,
but it wouldn't be necessarily you've got 10 heroin and 2 cocaine, and they're not broken down that finely, and so it's kind of hard to quantify. But we know it's up dramatically.
So how are, is this a problem with more of young people, like teenagers and people in their 20s, or is it kind of all
ages?
Well,
that's one of the big categories, the large categories, and also one of the ones that draws the most concern.
Right.
You've got, young people that, again, are trying something that sometimes on the very first time is a death sentence. And drugs affect everyone. I mean, I want to be clear about that. This is an equal opportunity punisher. It's not, bad communities and bad kids or any of that stuff. It's very oftentimes good kids and good communities, good parents, good schools, and just, one wrong turn.
Right.
And so it's very concerning, very deadly situation. So. Something we're very involved in. My narcotics enforcement team has it at the top of its list to seek out and destroy, the sourcing of heroin on our streets and any methodology that gets it here, oftentimes from Mexico or Afghanistan, mm-hmm. the two most common suppliers. And to the extent we can shut it off, we're doing everything we can. To the extent we can inform the public, we do as we are right now. We go to schools, we talk to kids, we tell them the dangers, we let them know that, like I said, sometimes even on the first attempt, it kills you. And It's important for people to understand that. It's, you know, at one point it was somewhere between 8 and 10%, maybe strength you might see in a typical bindle, maybe 15, 20 years ago. Sometimes you get up between 60 and 90% on some of the things that we've tested right behind us in our crime lab here. So you have no idea what it's going to be. It's literally a Russian roulette where you're spinning it, then you don't know what's going to come on 50 or 90. And if it's on 90, you know, that's a loaded chamber.
Now, if a parent or someone that that cares about somebody suspects that the person they care about is doing heroin, what should they do? How do you react to that?
Do everything you can to intervene. It may not be heroin. It might be depression. It might be other kinds of drugs. It might be, you know, bullying, whatever it is. If you see dramatic change in someone's behavior, get involved. Let them know you care, and don't take no for an answer, because sometimes this happens very slow, but more often than not, it may develop very quickly. And if you don't have some kind of intervention and some kind of supportive role, hey, I'm here for you, you know, we got to make sure that we get you, you know, help on the right path, whatever, however you verbalize it, you need to do it, because, you know, sadly, I've had too many parents sitting in the chair where you are today that have lost a son or a daughter.
Right. Now, are there organizations that you would recommend people talk to if they want helping somebody?
Well, obviously the internet brings a great deal of information. We have information on our website, our narcotics enforcement team. We do community events, but you know, you can Google a lot of that and look for ideas and thoughts, and I would encourage people to do that.
Now, I know that I've heard from parents, like in this situation, that kids are afraid, like if they're at a party or their friend's house and somebody's overdosing or having a reaction to something,
right,
they're afraid to call the police and they're afraid to call for help. Is that really an issue, or are people protected if they call for an ambulance for somebody?
There's been efforts to change the laws and make it real clear that the Good Samaritan Act of someone, you know, wouldn't put them at risk. You know, people are concerned they're in a drug house and they may be ancillarily charged, or, you know, as long as you're not the provider of that drug that kills somebody, if you just happen to be there, generally, you know, the law enforcement community is appreciative that you made the phone call.
And are the penalties for selling this, you're pretty tough on people when you find out that they're distributing, right?
Yeah, and penalties obviously are adjusted based on quantity and you know, what you're actually up to. If you've got a bindle for personal use and it's possession, you know, the penalties are pretty low, and we try to make sure you get into treatment or get some assistance. If you've got, you know, a kilo in your trunk, you know, now the world's going to come down on your shoulders.
Now, can you talk about how big, have you had any really big, like, busts? Have there been, like, truckloads of this stuff coming in, or does it tend to be smaller amounts?
Oh, yeah, we've actually, you know, had some very serious seizures of heroin and cocaine right in Oakland County. I mean, as I said, it's an equal opportunity punishment. It comes into all communities, affects all families. And, you know, every time we get a chance, we do what we can to interdict it, interrupt it, and send a clear message.